Originally from Arkansas, and I met Stephen last year at the Midwest Tennessee Genealogical Society, and he's been a wonderful member of the society, and now he's come to Bemis Historical Society. We're very glad to have him come here. So, Stephen, if you'll come on, I'm going to let you tell a little bit more about yourself along with your program. Okay? Thank you.
Well, there's not much to tell. Usually when I mention the word Arkansas, people around here say we won't hold it against you, you know. But, I'm a Razorback. I'm not a player in fact, of course. But I moved to Tennessee in 2005 and fell in love with Jackson. I was working for the Phillips family over in Memphis. I was in the music business for several years. It ended with working with the select events out of Memphis. And I've always enjoyed genealogy. I got into it when I was a kid, believe it or not. And it's from one of my homeroom teachers when I was in the seventh grade. She sent us home a sheet of paper that looked like a basketball bracket. You know what I'm talking about. And so I thought, well, are we getting ready to play a basketball game or something? Or what? What is this? She said, no, here's what I want you to do. Go home at dinner tonight. I want you to talk to your folks. And I want you to write your name right here, then I want you to write your folks' name, and then they're going to help you with the grandparents and the great-grandparents, and let's just see what happens. I thought, well, you know, it's dinner around my table isn't all that great. You know, I'm a kid. You know, my dad was a Free Will Baptist minister. My mom was a sweet little humble Christian lady who played the piano. And so, we talked about this and that, and we talked about church and what's going on with the church that week. And we got through eating, so I brought this bracket up and I said, hey, my teacher wants us to start working on our family tree here, and I'm going to start right here. And I've already got you in here. What else can you guys add? And man, they went to town on me all of a sudden. I said, man, where did y'all get this? All this energy all of a sudden. You know, my folks were a lot older than me. My folks were the same age as all my friends and grandparents. You know, my mom had me when I was 41 years old. So, anyway, that's the way that. Anyway, but I'm very happy to be in Tennessee now. I love Tennessee. I met my wife here, as a matter of fact, and we've been together since 2006, and it's just been absolutely wonderful. We had to leave for a little bit because I'm kind of semi-retired, and I'm just following her around with her job. So we went to Northwest Arkansas for about 4 years, went to Florida for about 3 years, and then I found out we was coming back to Jackson. I got all excited. I said, all right, and then to get up here and find out the Jackson Generals aren't here. I said, we're leaving. And then she talked me into hanging around, and so we've been working on the house and getting it ready. Today, at 1 o'clock, if you can see my shirt, I've got the new logo here. This is the new ball team. It's the name of the new ball team. Y'all know the name of the new ball team? It's the Jackson Rockabillys. And I submitted that name back in March in the contest. And I was, remember they called that name today? I was at the ballpark, and there was about 50 or 60 people there. The TV stations were there, the radio people were there. And man, I jumped with joy and made a lot of noise and everything. And the owner standing there, and she turned around and said, yeah, you and 64 other people. I said, what do you mean? She said, 65 people put in for that Jackson Rockabilly's name. Well, I was impressed with that, but I still want to be number one, you know. So anyway, she said, well, here's what we'll do. You're going to be in the drawing. So they get this big basket and put all these names in there. And the winner is going to win season tickets and a limo ride to all the home games. And guess who won? Not me. I'm not sure who won. So anyway. All right, let's get started on some fun stuff here, because this is my favorite presentation. I love talking about this. I love talking about photos. Mainly because there's a lot going on with photos these days. When I say a lot going on, it really means there's nothing going on. You know, you've got those photos sitting in your closet up there at the top. You've got that shoebox up there in the corner that's kind of buried. I need you guys to get those down after tonight. I need to get them down. Make sure they're all out in plain sight, because your job is to get those photos labeled. Do you know everybody that's inside those photos? Do you know everybody that's in your photos? See, that's the problem. You've got to find out who's in those photos, and you've got to get them labeled to find out. Because if this crew that's coming up behind us, they're not going to know who did this, and they're not going to know who's in those pictures. And guess what? they're going to get thrown away or get put in an antique store or end up on the Cracker Barrel wall. That's exactly what's going to happen. Now, we love going to antique stores. That's one of our favorite things we do. And we recently went to Henderson. There was one in Henderson. If you're going out of Henderson, just happened to look over my shoulder, and there was a sign that said antiques. You kind of make a U-turn into it. You may know what I'm talking about. He just called it Henderson Antiques. And I walked around looking for photos because I didn't see the one. So I came over to him and I said, do you have any old photos that you've come across? He said, I'll be right back. He runs out to the car and he brings back these three photos right here. And I was just elated to have that. That one on the right reminded me of my grandfather because he was a barber. He's got a photo just like this. And this is that old cardboard.
Like this. Like this right here. These are my favorite, but these are white paper. That's why I like those.
And these go back to like the 20s or whatever. But these photos have nothing written on the back. So I have no idea what these are, where they came from, or whatever. At first, you know, I'm assuming that it came from Tennessee because I got them from Tennessee. You know. But this one, the fourth one, I blew up what was in the corner, and I wrote it on there. It says Enid Barber Supply Company, 309 North Grand, August 16th, 1920. Boy, did I jump for joy when I saw that. I said, okay, there's no names, but that's a start. So I got on the internet and started looking around and trying to find a historical society over there. And I ran into this, Downtown Enid History. And there's the 300 block on North Grand. As a matter of fact, at the top, the very top, you can see if I can pinpoint them up there, right up here along the top. Those are the names of the other streets. But the street I'm on right now is Grand, and that's where that was. So I just kept scrolling down thinking I was going to see that business, that Enid Barber Supply business. And I even looked up the address, and there is another business there now. But all they wanted to show was the Oxford Hotel. There was like four or five photos of that thing. And it caught fire back then, like in the 80s. 1980s, and they were making a big deal about that. But at the bottom, I was able to upload these photos onto that website. Not for everybody to see, but for whoever the administrator is going to get them and show them around to see if those people can be identified. In 1985, I was at my mom's house, and she had all these photos from her mother. And she was the oldest of seven kids, and she had all the photos. But when she died, my mom got all those photos. And not only that, but grandma's husband, my grandpa, his name was Grandpa Marvin White, he had one of those old box cameras, you know, those old 1910 Kodak box cameras where you look in there and everybody's upside down, and it didn't matter, you just had to get behind it. Those took beautiful pictures, and he would there was a moment there, I'm going through them and I'm seeing some dates. And I said, okay, this is like about 1920 or so. Well, he didn't live in Oklahoma anymore. He lived in New Mexico. His mom married a guy named Joe Ritchie, and they had a ranch out there. So he was taking pictures way out there in the middle of nowhere. I'm trying to figure out, how in the world are you developing photos out here? There's no Walgreens down the street, you know? And so he apparently got some chemicals through mail order or whatever, and they lived in a dugout, for those of you that remember those little dugouts. But they lived there for a few years, and he took a bunch of pictures of my great-grandma, her name was Samuel Briggs, and my mom, she was like 5 years old, and my aunt was like, well, she was born in 1922 there, but right about 24, 25, a big storm come up, Joe Ritchie went out to close the gate, and right when he got to the gate, he got hit by lightning, got knocked clean out of his boots. You know, well, that's just an anecdote. It sounds more fun when I say it like that. But he got killed instantly, so the family packed up and went back to Oklahoma. But there was a whole lot of photos from there. So I want to show you these right here. These photos, I picked these photos up out at the Red Barn. You know where the Red Barn is, I passed Gary Neeson's place out there on Highway 70. And man, I hit the mother load. I must have found quite a few photos that had names on the back. But my question is, if these are identified, why are they sitting in an antique store for sale? Where's the family? What's going on? Nobody knows about these. So here's what I did. I tried to clean it up a little bit. This is Hulda and Lucille Butler. And let's see. Let's see where I've got them located here. So I went to find a grave and look for them. And Hulda is the mother. And she, she's buried over at McCoy Cemetery in Beach Bluff on Hodge Chapel Road. Now, her parents were Jackson and Elizabeth Spry. I remember that name, Spry. All right, her husband was Samuel Butler. Now, Lucille Butler, that's the little girl, that was their daughter. Now, Lucille is buried in Freeway at the Antioch Baptist Church Cemetery, and she is Olin Sam's daughter. She was married to J.D. Graves, who is also buried there as well. Now, here's what I did with these photos. I went to findagrave.com, and I found their memorial. No photos. There might be a picture of the grave, maybe, but these are the first photos to be put there. The point is, the family members can come in. Now, listen, when it comes to these photos, some of these people get a little picky about it. They don't want you taking their photos. You know, don't lift my photos off the internet. Me, I don't care. I want all my photos taken. If you want my photo taken, put it where it needs to go. I can't get to their ancestry pages, but I know they exist on ancestry. So I emailed somebody that had them in their tree and told them I've got these photos available at Find a Grave. Go get them. Go there and save them and put them into ancestry. So there was two of them like that. I tried to clean them up a little bit. And these are the only ones I've had of them. But if we can get those posted somewhere, does anybody know this family? Does anybody in here know this family? Okay. The Butler family. Hulda J. Spry Butler, there's her Find a Grave page right there. And there's the photo that I posted for that one. And then there's Lucille. And I put the two photos there for her. And then that's her husband down there. I think J.D. Graves. Now, this is an interesting one. Now, this is the same photo. I tried to clean it up a little bit, but frankly, I don't think it needed it. I just put it side by side. This is Larkin Butler. He was born in 1848 and died in 1920. And that's it. It said Larkin Butler on the back. That's all it said. But when I got to searching for him, I found him. And he was born in Tennessee in 1848. His death certificate showed that he died in 1920 in Chester County. He's buried at New Friendship Cemetery in Mifflin. His father was George Butler, and there is a grave there that just says G.T. Butler. That could be him. That's how I have to verify that. Come to find out, there is over 45 people named Butler that's buried in that same cemetery. Does anybody know this guy? Okay, he must have got me a part of him. You know, I keep thinking they might be descendants of the doctor, Dr. William Butler, possibly. Possibility, you never know. Now, these next ones, this came from the same store right here. The first one is Elizabeth Valentine Blue, and that's her husband, John Michael Blue. And they're both buried in Ohio, and I'm thinking they must have had relatives in Tennessee, maybe. God, I couldn't figure out why those photos ended up there. It could be, you know, some of these traveling antique stores, they might be stopping and picking up stuff in estate sales or whatever. But the next one, Sam Stennis Oldsley, that was there. And I went to his Find a Grave page, nothing. I found him on Ancestry, no pages, no pictures, but he's there. So what I did with him, I posted it at Find a Grave, and I got in touch with a guy named, I think his name is William Oldsley, and he owns the Oldsley family tree in Ancestry, and he responded. He was very grateful to see that. Matter of fact, he was full. But let me tell you about Sam. There's not much to say about Sam except his father was Judge Robert Wade Oglesby, who was from Obion County and served as District Court Judge and Court of Appeals Judge, State Senator, and a member of the tax, the State Tax Commission under the Governor J.Y. Sanders administration, as well as State Representative of Obion County, Tennessee, where he lived before moving to Louisiana in 1903. So he was real busy before the turn of the century, seemed like. So now I've got his find a grave now also. Meet Tommy Spry. Now I'm thinking that Elizabeth Spry, who was married to Butler, I got to think they're connected there somewhere. I couldn't find it, and I didn't search for it that long, but I'm sure they're connected. But this is Private Tommy Spry. He was born in 1892 and died in 1933. He's a veteran of World War I. He's buried at Elizabeth Methodist Church Cemetery in Crockett County. And I found another Tommy Spry that picture. He was born find a grave. He was born in 1950 and died in 68. So this photo definitely wasn't for him, because this is a very, very old photo here. Maybe 1930, somewhere between 1925 and 1930. I had to clean it up just a little bit. All I did was just brighten it up. Some of these were a little bit dark. So, now, oh boy. For those of you who have heard this story, this is my embarrassing moment right here. I tried my best to blame this on my mom, but I just couldn't do it. And I'll tell you why in a minute. But this does happen. But right here on the back of this photo, upper right-hand corner, it says Charles, Wilford, and Mel, and right under that it says Grandpa Mel's mom. Well, I took that to be gospel. Boy, did I run with that. I put their names on the front. Charles is my great-grandfather up there on the left, is what that is. And because of that photo, I started in 2011, I started a Facebook page called Descendants of John Freeman Millsball, and that has been the home photo, the cover photo for that site for 10 years, or more like 11, okay? And that photo right there, that site, connected me with family members all over California, Oklahoma, Texas, Vancouver, Washington. I mean, they're just all of a sudden just coming in from everywhere. And here's the question I got from most of them. Who are you again? And why you got pictures of Grandpa? Why you got pictures? And I started posting pictures. I've got pictures of all their fathers and their grandfathers and their kids, and they won't know about that. Well, here's the reason. My grandmother was Essie Millsball. She's the oldest kid of that bunch. And these are all the kids of her brothers and sisters out there, you know, that are getting in touch with me. So that's why I had those photos, because my grandma, she was the leader of that. She practically raised those kids when mom died. Their mom died of tuberculosis back in 1903. You know, so anyway, there it is. I posted that Facebook page. I had it on there for a long time. I had it up on Ancestry, and people were taking it from Ancestry, putting it on their Ancestry pages. They're all got all. Everybody's got John Freeman Millsball in there now. He was married to a lady named Wilhelmina Wickham, who was Black Dutch that died over in Indiana, and they've got her at one of those grave sites that I can't remember what it is. It's like a city-owned site or whatever. They can't find her grave over there. But anyway, he had all these kids, and everything was going fine until my cousin, my DNA cousin from Vancouver, Washington, called me up, and he said, and we were talking about Elizabeth Hall Cemetery in New Lane, Arkansas, and he said, you know, we got some McCutcheons that are buried over there in that cemetery. I think we're related to some of those folks. And so while I got him on the phone, I'm scrolling through the website, and I'm looking, and I run across this, Samuel Newton McCutcheon, and I look down, and I see that guy right there. And I said, wait a minute. Man, that name down there at the bottom, I think her name's Tessie. Man, I clicked on that name and sent an email. I said, hey, what's my great-grandfather's picture doing on your Find a Grave page? And I got a response within just a few seconds. Said, that is not your great-grandfather. That happens to be my husband's great-grandfather, Samuel McCutcheon. Well, guess what?
There's the original photo. When make it embarrassing going further, I held it in my hand, and I took a picture of it with my phone, and I sent it to her, and I said, I've got the original photo right here. She says, well, I don't know how you got that, but that's not your grandfather. So I thought, okay, stop, calm down, take a breath. I got to doing some research and going through ancestry, and my aunt Ida Millsball, who was buried in that same cemetery, was married to a guy named Grover Washington, who is his cousin, and that's how we got that photo. And that photo got mixed up with all those Millsball photos. So Mom, if you remember on the back of the photo, when she wrote up here, she's got a question mark by each name. And I didn't pay any attention to it. I just got so excited and reacted too quick. So Mom is not to blame. But I got her to, but I tell you what, in 1985, I begged her to label all those photos that she had in there. She could name everybody in those photos, those old photos and all those books. And it took her 3 years to get it done, and she did it. She got them all done. This is the only one that I was about to blame her on, though. But that's Sam McCutcheon. I've come to the conclusion on that. Now let's talk about photo restoration just a little bit. I'm going to try to make this as easy as possible without getting into that technical stuff, all right? But, the best way to start is to start with a good scanner. I use the Epson, I think that's a V600 Perfection, and it's designed for photos. It will also do negatives and slides. And you can get a refurbished one for about $150, you can get a brand new one for about $300. They're really easy to use. You just hook it up to your computer, and you probably, these days, you can pretty much download the software and get it going. So let's see, take a look at it here. See, so the first thing that comes up here, let's see, make sure I'm on the right one here, is what you're looking at on the left. I've got listed on the right. You've got the scan settings, which you want photograph. The mode is photo mode, scan plus, and reflective, that's just automatically there. The 48-bit, I like, I scan in 48-bit color, because what that does, that is, like, when it scans it, it's like scanning a trillion colors, and then it breaks it down to about a million and some colors to get a good 24-bit color. I mean, it's the highest quality, not the highest quality, but it's a very good quality. And the DPI, which stands for dots per inch, that's in the photo. I usually set that at 300 or higher. Now, when you go to post something like that on the internet, the picture won't be about this big. You know, so if you post on the internet, you want to always remember to set it for 72. That's the main thing for that. But down here, now you got to set your, before you scan, you got to change the name of the file right here. And you got to put the file folder where it's going. And what kind of picture it is. A JPEG is the normal one to do. And then you hit scan, of course. So always scan the preview first. And then after you preview it, you go through and you can put a little block around it with your cursor. I think there's a cursor right there on this one. And then you want to copy it one at a time, but you got to change the name and then the settings each time. Them one at a time, then you save them, and then you can come back into Adobe Photoshop to restore them. We'll talk about that in a minute. But be sure you rename each one before you scan. This is a great program. It's really easy to use. Now we're into Adobe. Because if you get on with Photoshop Premiere, you're going to pay about $20 a month. You don't want to do that. This program is about $50 or $60. It's a one-time buy, and you're done. All you have to do is hook it up. Now, you might get updates probably in the next year or whatever, but you don't get charged for them. So let me see here. Let's see which folder this is. See,
Okay, so we do this. Okay, so now we're ready to edit. So when I open a photo, now what I like to do, up there at the top, it says, right there, I think it says, opening camera raw. You don't read that? I open the camera raw. What that is, you're kind of, you're making a digital negative. It's not necessary, but I do that just to have it on hand all the time. But the reason I open the camera raw is because there are some areas over there on the right that I use, and especially for a picture like this, I'm going to start with the exposure right there. Now, Ricky Long sent me this picture, and it came just like that. How, you see how dark it is? And he explained who it was, and I went through and did my adjustments on it, and brought it right back out. Now you see, I've got two arrows posted here. The one arrow is over on the left, is pointing to the T, because I'm gonna click on that, and then I'm gonna put the girl's name up there, which, I think her name's Addie. That was his, he said, the fifth person from the left is his grandmother or great-grandmother. I think it's his grandmother. Could be great-grandmother. She died in 1948, I believe. That one dates back to 1888. So the final result, what I'm going to do here, I'll put that arrow over there just to point to the person we need. Now I've got it. Change it to white, and I put a description at the top, Ag Center School Class, 1888, and then her name, Addie Francis Smith, and pointed to her. So now we got one person identified on the photo. Hey, that's better than nothing. But some of those old group photos like that, they're almost impossible to find out everybody that's in their photo. So the next one also came from Ricky Long. And this one is Smith's Chapel, labeled by Addie Smith Mosley as Mother's First School at Smith Chapel. The school was near Skullbone Community in Gibson County. People in the photo are Addie and her two sons. This photo was taken in 1907. Now, what I did here, this was not too tough, but all I did here was this area here. See all this writing? First thing I want to do is get rid of all that. So I took a tool off of Adobe and called it, it's called a clone stamp. It's a picture of the little rubber stamps that you'd use to stamp paper. And I just took it, and what I did was I clicked over in this area, and then I opened up the stamp, and what it would do, it would clone that and help me wipe this out. And then get all this erased out right here. Clone down here, erase here, clone here, erase there. Fairly easy. Sometimes it can get a little monotonous trying to do all that. You don't want. Sometimes you can do it all at once, but anyway. And this is the result. See how it's cleaned up at the bottom now? It looks like It looks like just the ground. And dated 1907. Addie Smith Mosley, Mother's First School at Smith Chapel. And I sent those back to Ricky. He really appreciated this. So this next one now, this is my little brother. Well, he's my older brother. I'll have you little brothers. I'm the little brother. But he was in my little league at this time. This photo has seen better days. This one was fairly messed up. Looked like he'd been carrying around his back pocket or whatever, you know. But I got to work on it with Adobe Shop elements. And there's the result. This one, however, though, I sent it over to Ancestry. They got a coloring program there now. I cleaned it up, got it colored, and I sent it to them. They said, wait a minute. That wasn't a colored photo. What are you doing? I said, well, it is now. Plus, we can actually see your face and part of your uniform now. So that worked out real well on that one. And there he is again. This is this photo here. This was one of those square photos, black and white. And it was folded four ways and probably carried around his wallet for who knows how many years. And that's him on this is a few years later, it's about 19, I think that Little League shot was probably 59, and this is probably 62. And this is over in Paris, Arkansas. You see that old car sitting in the background. Our uncle, they did a lot of car work up there. He had a big salvage yard and everything. But on this one, I used a healing brush. You can use a clone stamp. But you click over here in this area, like on this one, let's go back. Click over here to get rid of this line. I just click right there, and then I pulled up that healing brush and just start painting right from here. Okay? And I did the same thing up here. Now sometimes I had to get out the healing brush, like where that tire is. Okay? And that's that. It was a kind of a, you know, some of those old photographs, those, it looked like, I don't know, who was it? Was it the Polaroids that when you pulled it out, they had the little ridges around the outside of the photo? Or did you get them developed like that? I can't remember. Okay, I thought so. I couldn't remember. That's what that looked like. You know, it's not just a square photo. It's got that neat little design around it. Now, how many of you still have your baby brother? One, two, three? You still got yours, bro? And somebody's got it. My brother called me back in February. He said, "You're not going to believe what I just found." Now, let me tell you one thing about this. There has been a big controversy on my great-grandmother's name, whether it's men's or sins. That's what happens when you get DNA cousins calling in. All of a sudden, they want to change things in the tree. You've been working on for 30 years. You know? So my cousin Bob Harrison called me from Vancouver, Canada. This was a little bit later on. And he said, "Hey, I think I found something. They found in the census that her name, there was a Nancy Sims. And it was in Floyd County, Georgia, where they lived." Well, you know, my great-grandfather, his name was Richard Barry Harrison, he was a school teacher down there in Georgia. And Nancy was one of his students, and they got married when she was 17. He was 25. Now, I should have scanned it, but inside that book, my mom put down that her name was Mims. And that proved it right there. That's the main reason my brother called me. He said, "Here's your proof right here. That's good enough." And then I got another cousin out of Texas that just found me. She found a census that I had right in front of my face that showed them there, showed Richard and Nancy there. And then I looked, and she said, "Look up. You never looked up, did you?" And I looked up, and there's her folks are up here, David Sims and all them. They lived on the same street. I was expecting them in the same house. I wasn't. That's my scatterbrain. I do that sometimes. So anyway, y'all recognize that handsome fella right there, right? That's me. That's about 1960. I think I'm 4 years old right there. I just gave it all away. And this photo was really damaged. Mom had put it in the back and glued it to the glass page back there. It just gathered a lot of problems. So let's start editing it. So first thing I did, I tried to repair the background by coloring it out a little bit. We got a little bit carried away and did too much at once. Then I came back and blew it up a little bit, and I started working around the edges, and it was getting rough, and I was messing that up. It just didn't look right at the top up there. And, well, now it's reaching frustration level, and I can't get it to cooperate. So then I finally come up with the idea, look, just gray out that. Just gray the sky out completely. So I did. There it goes. I smoothed it out. I still got the trees back there. I got it identified now. And that's the pretty much the cleaned up version right there. So I worked out pretty good. Now, this is my favorite one. This is the tough one. So there's my grandma on the right. And on the far left is her little brother Howard. And in the middle is her little brother Martin. My Uncle Howard, my Uncle Martin. Little Marvin's mouth is gone. So now I gotta figure out what to do. So I looked at it, started messing around with some of the backgrounds and the dress, trying to get things cleaned up a little bit. But I figured I got to looking, okay, so Grandma's mouth, it looks like it's in pretty good shape, and these kids are related. So I just went up here where she is and cropped it, put it on him, and cleaned up the background. So that worked out pretty good, and then I've got each of them identified right there. So anyway, this is just a great way to restore photos with Adobe Photoshop Elements. That's right now. There's a lot of different programs. things out there. This just happened to be my favorite. Questions? Anybody have any questions? No questions. This is one of my favorite programs to give. I'm going to be doing this in Wheatley County here in a few weeks too. I'm going to get them on the internet sooner or later. But what's your job now? You know what your job is? Get your photos identified. Get the pens out. And the best thing to do is for some of those old Kodak pictures that you write on with a pen, you know, they want to smear. I go to the store and I buy labels, those small address labels, things like that, and I put those on the back and write their names on it like that, and that preserves it really well. And I also noticed in this museum, it looks like there's a whole bunch of pictures back there somebody needs to get work on. Thank you very much. I sure appreciate it.